All right. Yeah. So welcome. I hope everyone's Friday has been good so far. Thank you so much for coming to our 2020 BIC hosted by Entrepreneurship at Cornell and powered by Life Changing Labs. We are super excited to have everyone here and listen to all of our wonderful judges and our wonderful teams present their big ideas. So we're just going to kick off the event really quickly by having Peter present a little bit of an introduction about our co-host, Entrepreneurship at Cornell. Peter, are you here? Okay, it's looking like Peter might have a technical difficulty. One second here. Sorry, bear with us, guys.
Yeah, I just, Peter's trying to get onto the link. So Lucy, if you just wanna go into the overview while I get Peter the link, that'd be great. Or
yeah, of course. So I could give you guys a quick overview as to how the event is going to be presented today. So there will be 12 pitches happening, six from the general track and six from the social track. We will be, all of the pitches will be 3 minutes long, and there will be a 3 minute Q&A from the judges. We're aiming towards around two questions from the judges to each team, just so that everyone gets a chance to have questions answered or asked throughout the entire process. We will be going with the general track first and the social track second. And so the exciting thing is we also have a People's Choice Awards, and we're gonna have raffles. So what's going to happen is for the People's Choice Awards, the audience member is going to have a say in what their favorite venture is. That's super exciting. We will be releasing a poll towards the end of the competition, and you will be able to vote for one out of 12 teams. And that team will get $300 in prize money, which is really exciting. Yay. Something else that's happening is our raffles. So we have $100 allocated to five winners. So at the end of the competition, if you manage to stick around for that long, we will be randomizing and choosing five people out of all of our attendees, and we will be giving them a $20 gift card to a store of their choice. Really excited for that. So stay tuned and stay till the end for all of the prizes and all of the announcements.
Great. And then Peter should be signing in just a second. He has the link, he's coming on, we'll make sure he is not on mute.
Sounds great.
Hey, Timmy, is everyone
here? Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Okay. All right. So we'll get go ahead and get started. Sorry about that, everyone. I had trouble connecting into the link, but happy to have the Big Idea hosted for the first time virtually here. My name is Peter Cordell. I work at Entrepreneurship at Cornell with Zach Shulman, Deb, and the rest of the staff. My pleasure to be here today with some distinguished judges who we'll get to in a moment. But for those in the audience who have not yet been introduced to Entrepreneurship Cornell, we are the university-wide program that helps to foster the entrepreneurial spirit in participants, so namely students across college. And, you know, Big Idea Competition is one of the program's initiatives that, we run for undergrads specifically. So many of the participants today pitching for the first time through Big Idea, and others who have a bit more experience. But yeah, and we have many other kind of programming offerings that we do all throughout the year. And Big Idea is one of the earliest kind of entry points for students interested in entrepreneurship. We do want to very much thank Vijay and then the endowment his family has created to support Big Idea Competition. Without it, it wouldn't be possible. So, you know, very much appreciate the support to make Big Idea Competition possible for our students. And then also would like to quickly, as we go through slides here, thank the judges for their time. So Lucy, if we could perhaps go over to the next screen. Yes, so we have some distinguished judges here. Many here are part of the entrepreneurship at Cornell's advisory council. So if anyone in the audience who would like to learn more about that, please feel free to reach out. But if I could put the judges on the spot a little bit here, in the order, I think alphabetized by last name, just like quickly, if you're able to unmute yourself, quick introduction so others can kind of see who you are. And I think many of you are meeting for the first time virtually like this. So yeah, would we be able to kind of quickly go through the list? I can't see everyone on my screen, so.
Sure. Hey, everybody. My name is Saif Ajani. I'm co-founder at a company called Keyhole, which is an internet technology SaaS company based out of Toronto, Canada. I'm also a Johnson 09 alum and an investor in a number of tech startups ranging from SaaS to AI.
Hi, everyone. I'm Susan Danziger. I am on the advisory council of Cornell for entrepreneurship. Former arts and science alum. I'm both a founder, I've founded a number of tech companies and otherwise, as well as an investor in a number of companies focusing now currently on impact investing, particularly with respect to climate.
Hi everyone, my name is Colin Day and I am a Cornell grad from 97 in psychology, arts and sciences. And I'm the founder and now chairman of a company called iSims. We're a SaaS company based in central New Jersey, about 1,000 people. We focus on a recruiting platform, helping corporations kind of manage the attraction, the engagement, and the hiring of all the employees in their company. And ran that for about 20 years and have just stepped out of the CEO role into the chairman role. I'm very happy to be here.
Great, I'll round this off. Hi, everyone. My name is Stephanie Koh. I am a Johnson Dyson alum, class of 2014. I'm currently working at DoorDash as a enterprise manager. So I'm actually responsible for building out DoorDash's white label logistics platform specifically for retailers. So Macy's, Bloomingdale's, and Petco's of the world. So looking forward to being here and thank you again for having us.
Great. And we actually have one additional slide for judges. So if Lucy, we could continue. Yep.
Hi, I'm Ryoko. I'm with Kaiga Venture Fund. We are a VC fund based in Ithaca. So I'm based in Ithaca. If anyone is around here and want to try, let me know. I'm also a Johnson grad from 2016.
Hi there, everybody. My name is Otto Pohl. I am Cornell 92, and I am also a four-time founder and also and currently a consultant, a startup communications consultant. So I help companies find their story and tell their best story and get the word out. I'm excited to be here. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Marissa Saporta. I graduated from Ag, majored in business administration, 99. About 6 years ago, I co-founded and today I'm co-CEO of Guerrilla Commerce. Guerrilla Commerce is a product development platform. We specialize in launching powerful brand names online in the e-commerce marketplace.
Pam, you're on mute. Oh, Pam.
Pam, you're muted.
Yes. So perhaps Lucy or the team who has the ability to unmute could help with that.
Yeah, I've clicked the... There we go.
My name is Pam Silverstein. I'm a Johnson MBA from the 70s, when there was only a handful of female students and even less entrepreneurs, both sexes. I've been an entrepreneur since then. I'm thrilled and delighted to see so many female judges and so many female applicants for the big idea this year. I am honored to be the entrepreneur in residence at Life Changing Labs, where we ignite the entrepreneurial spark, we fan it, and we help you keep it burning throughout your journey. On behalf of the most amazing team I've ever worked with at LCL, welcome to the Big Idea 2020. We hope you enjoy it as much as we did planning it. Thank you.
And thank you to all judges like for taking the time in the midst of all the busyness and all the things that you know we had a chance to kind of hear about directly from you, that you would take the time out to connect with students, to give back in this way, and to judge our future entrepreneurs at Cornell. So yeah, thank you all. And perhaps we could give all everyone in the audience like a virtual round of applause, and even the participants to the judges. So thank you so much. I do, before handing things off to Lucy, getting right into the presentations, I do want to take a moment to thank the LCL student team. So they, we partnered up Entrepreneurship Cornell with LCL in organizing and running this event, and through the LCL team in terms of like the outreaching, you know, it's always very beneficial in terms of, you know, student, letting other student peers know about these opportunities. But beyond that, like all the things that goes on behind the scenes. So, you know, for recent weeks, first time doing this virtually, a lot of things that needed to get sorted out, coordinated, you know, getting back to every single applicant. So not only the finalists, the students that you see here who were matched up with mentors and got some feedback along the way. But yeah, getting back to like all students, encouraging them, giving them feedback, so they take the next steps, regardless of making it to the finalist round. So if I listed all the things that they have done behind the scenes, this would take too long. But yeah, thank you to the LCL team making it possible. And then, you know, doing all the things, including, you know, I was getting, I think, close to midnight last night, some text messages and such, because they really care about not only what they do, but the entire Cornell entrepreneurship community. And I think that shines through when you see, you know, the level of detail and late night messages when, you know, juggling things as a student at the same time. So yeah, perhaps another big round of applause to the LCL team for all their hard work. And with that, without further ado, handing things, I believe, off to Lucy, the student president of LCL, to go right into the pitches.
Wow, thank you, Peter, for that. That was big words being said, and we appreciate every one of you guys being here, and we love to support the entrepreneurship community at Cornell. So without further ado, that was a very long intro, but very much needed. Let's jump right into what everyone is anticipating, which is the general track. I believe the first people that we will be presenting today is Propel, and I will stop sharing my screen so that they will be doing that. So yeah, feel free to start sharing your screen whenever.
That's a proper bid.
Sorry, proper bid. That was a word spasm. Yes, proper bid.
Okay, sorry, I'm sharing screen right now. All right, let me know if everybody can see okay, whenever it loads. Let me know if everybody done? Cool. Hi, I'm Sam, and I'm a co-founder of Proper Bid. We're working to modernize construction bidding. So this is my uncle, Art. He has a job as a property manager for a residential building in New York City. He basically is responsible for overseeing all maintenance and construction that needs to be done in the building. One day, I was there helping him out at work when he realized that he needed to hire somebody to replace the boiler in the building. What I saw him do next really surprised me. He pulled out one of these, a big old clunky yellow phone book, which most of you probably never use anymore. He started going line by line and calling each contractor in the area to ask them how much it would cost them to replace the boiler And each of these contractors will then have to send him a whole formal document called a bid for him to read through before selecting a contractor with the best price. This seemed crazy to me. The CV was just my uncle who was behind the times. We spoke to over 130 property managers and 80 contractors. And we continuously heard this process is outdated, inefficient, and wasteful. At least the projects being delayed by months and the property managers having no way to know if they're even getting a quality contractor. So meet proper bid. The way it works is pretty simple. Property managers post a listing with the job that needs to be done, such as replacing the boiler. Contractors can then browse listings and place their bid and their price point for how much they would charge to do the job. Property managers can then select a bid after seeing all them and leave a review of the contractor based on how the job was done. This allows the property manager to know if they're getting a reliable contractor and saves so much time, and the contractors to have much more exposure and work opportunities and way less administrative overhead than they had before. Our go-to-market strategy is to start with my uncle's building, since we've been working with them as we go forward to learn about their pain points and are iterating based on their feedback. We could then expand to other buildings in the same network of New York City and then beyond. And our business model is very simple. We charge property managers a monthly fee to be on the platform, and we also charge 4.5% commission for transactions that are made directly on proper bid. So Jordan and I are the team. We've collaborated on a variety of startups here at Cornell in the past, including Sooner Breakfast and QBuddy. I know this construction space incredibly well since my entire family's in it. I've been around it my entire life, and I know it's so outdated and really needs to be changed right now. And it's also really related to our mission and impact. So one of the contractors actually in this phone book is my own father. And I've seen how hard it is as a small business to find work opportunities and hear about them. And we want to help small business owner contractors like my father and more at a time when they need us more than ever before. So thank you so much for listening. $3,000 would really allow us to launch. It's all we need are a couple of web hosting and AWS fees. This industry is so outdated and needs to change right now. Thank you so much for listening.
Awesome. Very nice speech. Thank you for that. Now we are moving on to judge Q&A. So any of the judges, if you have any questions for Sam or Jordan, feel free to unmute yourself and ask.
For the sake of time, we'll keep the Q&A period to 2 minutes. Okay, go ahead.
Do you mind if I ask how many contractors you have on board? It seems like you have good market for the property management side, but how about the contractor side?
Yeah, so like I said, we've spoken with over 80 contractors, and from their point of view, it's so difficult to call to find work opportunities. I know this from my own dad. He literally sits here sometimes waiting, hoping a building will call him for an opportunity, and like it's very difficult for them to find outreach. And all these 80 contractors who we spoke to said, if you could find me a better way to get work, find more work opportunities for me that's less administrative overhead, then I'm completely on board.
Sam. Oh, go.
No, I'm sorry.
Yeah. How are you guys planning on advertising to get the property managers and the contractors aware of the site?
Yeah, so like Sam said before, I think it's kind of like the Uber model in a sense. So we know that these property managers are really desperate and willing to spend money for solutions to find cheaper contractors and things like that. And once that demand is there, we're very confident that the supply will be there as well, because these contractors, like Sam said, are having so much trouble, especially now, finding work, even though all these buildings need renovation and need fixes to the buildings. So we're pretty confident that we'll be able to grow that way. So from recommendations or people just talking about it that way, and from property managers that we already have and contractors that they have used in the past is exactly where we're going to start and then hopefully grow from there.
Yeah, and we're in a unique advantage here because we're working with my uncle's building, who is like already on board and helping us as we iterate and like learn from them to build the best product. And they're associated with other networks of building in the city who we can then easily expand to. And these property managers are all communicating. They change buildings a lot. So once we establish that initial network, we could grow within New York City initially.
Can I ask what the competition is at this point? I wonder, are there other platforms that are doing something similar to what you're doing?
For the sake of time, we're keeping it 2 minutes per pitch for Q&A. So we'll have to move on to the next pitch.
Wait, how about if the question's asked, let's finish it. Yeah.
I can give a super quick answer to that one. So there are a few construction bidding management apps and things out there, but most of them are faced construct, like the contractor side. However, we're focused on the property management side. So people who are managing a bunch of properties, so multiple buildings, we make it easy for them to manage all of their bids throughout all of the buildings in each of the cities that they're in. So that's kind of where we're focused versus most of the other ones are focused on these smaller renovations and on the actual contractor side.
Thank you. Great presentation, by the way. I wish that you had spoken more in the presentation in terms of next time you'll have to be the one doing the main pitch.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I'm so glad that so many judges are interested in all of the things that we have to say for a proper bid. Next, we have Commonwealth. If you guys could share your screen, that'd be great.
Do we have time to actually do this scoring? Can you give us a minute?
Yeah, if you want a minute now, that's fine. In the future, during the Q&A period would be the time. So we can take a minute now.
Okay, I think Commonwealth can start at 11:24, or sorry, at 2:24.
Is it civility? Is that the same one?
No, civility is a different one.
Oh, Commonwealth. Oh, I see. Ah, yes, see. Got it.
Okay, cool. Am I good to go?
Yep, good to go.
Okay. Hey, how's it going, everyone? My name is Henry, and I'm working on Commonwealth. So what's the problem here? Well, choosing a place to live, taking out a loan, and buying insurance are all really big, important decisions. And when it comes to young people, they overwhelmingly rely on the internet to help them make these big decisions. So why isn't there a reliable, anonymous review site to help young people make these crucial decisions for their lives? Now, obviously, that's a lot of verticals to go after at once. So the starting point with all of this is off-campus housing right here in Ithaca. And this is based on my own conducting of over 50 customer interviews, as well as my own personal experience searching for an apartment. And I really found three things. The first one is that reviews are sort of all over the place, and they're not always anonymous, which often leads tenants to feel uncomfortable expressing their true opinions about their landlords or their apartments or houses. And finally, popular review sites like Yelp and Google are great for finding a restaurant to eat, but aren't really ideal for long-term services like real estate. And that results in three things. The first thing is that the good landlords don't get the recognition they deserve. The bad landlords don't feel the need to improve their services, and tenants ultimately lose out. So introducing Commonwealth. Commonwealth is a review platform for personal finance, insurance, and real estate, starting with off-campus housing in Ithaca. Imagine a platform like Glassdoor for all your personal needs outside of work. The long-term mission, of course, is to give young people transparency when it's time to make major financial, insurance, and real estate decisions. Now, the go-to-market strategy, I'm currently working on the website right now. It'll be done over winter break, and then we'll do a writer launch at the start of next semester. And then for about a month or so, we'll only be focused on writer growth. So we'll just be building up a critical mass of reviews using incentives like raffles and other things. And then about a month later, sometime in February, there will be a reader launch once we reach a critical mass of reviews. the business model is twofold. The first component of it is a premium subscription service for businesses where they can do things like reply to reviews, post custom branding, but in no cases just freely delete reviews. That's something that we would take very seriously for the integrity of the platform. And then the second component is targeted ads. A little bit about myself. My name is Henry. I'm a junior in ILR, minoring in info sci and business. Past experience includes working at a mortgage tech startup, and I'm sort of running everything right now, seeking to expand the team. And I'll use the $3,000 for four things. So expertise, marketing, incorporation, and servers and API calls. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your presentation. Now we have judges Q&A.
Henry, do you think you're going to be doing too many things on this? Like you've three whole projects you're trying to work on. And, you know, usually if you devote it towards one, you can get one done well, but you've got three things, real estate, insurance, and have you thought about that?
Well, so that's why for now we're only focusing on housing in Ithaca. Mm-hmm. Like I said, like what exactly what you just said basically is that it's too many verticals to attack at once. So really for, I would say the first few months to a year, I'm only collecting reviews on off-campus housing in Ithaca. And then, you know, once we build up a substantial user base for that, we can start to take it to, you know, I know students here don't really, they're not really taking out, you know, loans and buying insurance too often while they're students at Cornell. But then, you know, after we build up the user base, we can expand to major cities. Where students are moving after graduation, and then we can start including those features. But for now, it's just focusing on off-campus housing.
Henry, why only the younger demographic? I used to think I was young, but now I'm old. So you're kind of adopting this audience base, let's just say, you know, in their young 20s, but then you're going to lose them, you know, in 5 years because you're not catering to them anymore.
That's a really good question. For me, I think it's the pandemic and the whole trend of working from home has accelerated this trend where young people nowadays are kind of moving all over the place. It's not just to major cities like New York and LA. It's really all over the place. And young people move to cities where they don't have large personal networks. And so they can't go and ask their friends in these places, you know, what's a good landlord or what's a good insurance provider, because they simply like don't have those networks. Whereas like older crowds, you know, tend to have more relationships that they can count on, making sort of a big review site like that less necessary.
Okay, thank you so much for all of your questions. We will be moving on to Rehab. If you can share your screen really quickly.
Lindsay, you ready?
Good to go. All right. Saturday, August 2nd, 2014. A seemingly normal Saturday, except for the residents of Toledo, Ohio. Families across the town began to fall gravely ill. The culprit? A harmful algae bloom that had settled around the city's water intake pipe, contaminating the drinking water with microcystins. Unfortunately, this story goes beyond just Toledo. Harmful algae blooms, known as HABs, threaten the health of humans, animals, and ecosystems across the world, and even pose a threat to residents and wildlife near Ithaca's very own Cayuga Lake. To combat this, we at Cornell iGEM are proud to present Rehab, a novel community-oriented microcystin detection and degradation system designed to rehabilitate our local aquatic environment. Our project focuses on the detection and degradation of microcystin LR, also known as MCLR, one of the most common but most poisonous pollutants released by HABs. MCLR poisoning has resulted in many recorded fatalities in livestock, and it can cause kidney and liver damage or even cancer in humans. To make matters worse, it is nearly impossible to degrade naturally. To address this complex issue, Rehab takes a three-pronged approach. First, identification. Currently, HAB control is focused on prevention, detection, and monitoring. These techniques are expensive and have limited functionality. For example, the current diagnostic enzyme-linked immunoabsorbent assay, also known as ELISA, still takes a full day to yield results. Rehab has a vastly quicker diagnostic time of just a few hours and the added ability to degrade detected microsystems. Second, detection. We have developed an aptamer-based spectrometric detection sensor. Compared to other MCLR detection methods, our system has excellent sensitivity and stability, real-life testing and success, cheap and fast results, and excellent reproducibility. We have also developed an automated water sampling system that uses our sensor, the HABCAB, greatly reducing the need for in-person work. Third, remediation. Conventional methods to remove microsystems are practically non-existent. We have designed a bacterial filtration pathway that sequentially breaks down MCLR, which is significantly more cost-effective and efficient than current techniques. We then designed a capsule-based bioreactor to house the bacteria, allowing us to break down MCLR in a more controlled environment and to prevent leakage and contamination. HABCAB will also house this bioreactor, as well as being able to physically remove HABs to enable both detection and remediation. So moving forward, we hope to fully implement rehab into our community to aid in the detection and the remediation of harmful algae blooms in Cayuga Lake. Harmful algae blooms continue to drain the resources of lakeside communities all across the globe. And using rehab as a starting point, we envision a future in which people will no longer be threatened by these toxins. Identification, detection, remediation. Rehab is a revolutionary new approach to a pressing global issue.
Time.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your presentation. Now I will be passing on to judges for Q&A.
Can I ask a question? This is all. Can you tell me, first of all, do you actually ever done all this work and this is actually like a real solution? And what's your business model?
Yeah, so we've actually built up the model. There's a member of our team here, Jackson, who can talk to you a little bit more about what that implementation was like. But real quick, I will talk on just the business implementation of that. One of the things that we did struggle with is a lot of times lake waters are restricted or are private property. And so we thought by just working locally with Cayuga Lake, we could just promote the idea that, hey, solutions do exist and really at least advance the field by making people aware of the fact that there are other ways, for example, to detect microsystems and be a front runner in that push to faster detection techniques and remediation techniques and so on.
Yeah, and like Lindsay mentioned, we have actually implemented this system on a small scale. You saw the video of the boat. That's our collection and detection system for the microsystem. And we have also built a bioreactor system where we flow the water through our engineering system and it comes out at the other end with the microsystem degraded.
Related to that, who is going to buy your system? Is that the county?
Yeah, so definitely the county could be someone who's like a definite potential customer. Another thing is going back to that distinction of public and private property. If people who do privately own areas feel the urge to clean up their own lakes or waterways, they could also be potential customers.
Yeah, and to add on to that, we're planning on starting small, so with private businesses who are direct stakeholders in these affected bodies of water. And we're hoping to eventually expand to a point where we can appeal to government agencies as well as local and state governments so that we can encourage some kind of cross-sector collaboration that encourages just more responsibility and awareness of these bodies of water.
Awesome.
Brian, what will you do with the money? Oh, can I ask a question or are you done? I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, Pam. I think
that's okay. No, I understand.
Yeah, two questions per team. We're trying to do
okay.
It.
My apologies. Brian.
Thank you for all of your questions and responses. Yeah. And next we have
Can I add something real quick?
Yeah, of course.
So if it's okay with you guys, this idea did start with a competition that we were a part of. It is a nonprofit organization. IGEM itself stands for Internationally Genetically Engineered Machines. And if you guys want to learn more about our approach and our plans and our next steps, we will gladly attach two links to our website. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Okay, next we have civility.
Hey, everyone, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Evan. I'm a sophomore studying development sociology and government, and I'm the founder of Civility, a social networking solution for local and state politics. So here's the problem. There's incredibly low voter turnout among younger voters for local and state elections. 78% of young voters do not vote in local and midterm elections. And this translates to 57 million people, young voters in the US, who are not voting. And these are the people we're targeting with Civility. So in order to better understand the problem, I went out there and talked to people. I found that 83% of young people are willing to learn more about local and state politics. The problem is that the current methods of engagement are lacking. A common thread throughout all these conversations was that people at this age group wanted social media platforms. In other words, they wanted a solution that they're familiar with. So I present to you Civility, a nonpartisan social media platform. Civility has two main components. On one hand, all you have to do is give your zip code and it'll automatically populate a feed with posts from your current local and state elected representatives. The other side of the app, you'll be able to follow and donate to campaigns. Now, what sets Civility apart from other social media apps is that it has features that are uniquely designed for political engagement, such as virtual town hall meetings, polling for constituent feedback, a sample ballot where users can plan out who they're going to vote for, and embedded donations where you can donate directly on the platform. Now, for constituents, what we want to do is help them make their voices heard. We want to help them learn more about what's being done and hold their local representatives accountable. For politicians, what we want to help them do is expand their outreach and get specific feedback from their constituents. Civility seeks to be the bridge between constituents and politicians. We hope to monetize in three ways. One, a data analytics subscription for politicians. Two, a monthly platform fee for campaigns and advertisements. Winning the big ideas competition will greatly help us in the next steps. First, it'll help expand our interview capabilities and talk to more politicians. Next, it'll be a great step to beginning to build a prototype. Finally, it'll be the recognition to continue to build out a great team. And so Civility seeks to solve a really large problem. We can't claim to have a democracy if 78% of young people are not voting in local and state elections. Civility is committed to fixing this problem. So here is a photo from a few weeks ago when I decided to just go into the Commons with a table and a sign and talk to people. And I highlight this photo because it really speaks to the resourcefulness and the commitment to our user base that drives Civility. I believe that Civility can fix democracy from the ground up, and I hope you can too. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Evan, for your presentation. Next, we will have judges ask questions.
How many people came up to you when you were standing, you were sitting outside? Like, were people excited about this or was it ho-hum? What was the reaction?
Surprisingly, people were willing to talk. It was back to back with the interviews. I didn't really have a lull. And just speaking to people really helped me broaden my perspective and understand the pain points in a way that I could never have done just by myself and through my own research.
That's great. Too bad this didn't happen before the last election. So, no, but this is great. I'm very impressed with it.
Thank you, Pam.
I'm just curious, obviously this is something that would have a lot of applicability at a national level, but that's a huge, huge way to tackle it. Mm-hmm. How would you think about going about tackling this from a go-to-market approach or verticalization, or where would you start as you try to tackle it?
Yeah, it's important to keep in mind that I eventually plan to have this be a national solution. But initially I plan to start in Ithaca. I think I'm in a great position as a college student to be able to connect with Cornell students and Ithaca college students. And at these colleges, I plan on starting an ambassador program to basically kind of spread awareness about Civility as well as talk to students about the importance of local and state politics. And I plan on increasing my marketing strategies during different peaks. So in the spring during primaries and in the fall during elections.
Awesome. Thank you, everyone, for all of your great questions. Next, we have Waterfall.
Awesome. Hey, everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Cool. First of all, awesome presentations, everybody. These have been really, really cool. I'm Michael. I'm a 2020 electrical engineer, and I'm here to talk to you about Waterfall, a hydration solution for the elderly. So Thelma was one of my teammates, Teresa's grandma's. She has always struggled with drinking water and was recently hospitalized due to liver issues due to dehydration. We saw this was a huge problem. To find out more, we talked to the community in Ithaca, interviewing at 3 nursing homes and serving over 100 seniors. We found dehydration to be very common in the elderly community and a huge issue. For many, hydration is super easy. We feel thirsty, we have water accessible, and we drink. However, as we age, we begin to lose our sense of thirst. This problem is worsened by medication and diseases. Furthermore, accessibility to water becomes harder as seniors struggle with fine motor skills and mobility. This is a problem that affects 52 million senior citizens in the US alone. One telling fact is that 31% of long-term care residents are dehydrated, and these are people with reliable and consistent caretakers. This issue has resulted in over $1 billion spent on it annually. One current solution to this problem are smart water bottles. These rely on phone reminders and phone texts and Bluetooth. Though performing well on the market, they target healthy, mobile, tech-savvy, and younger individuals. On the other hand, the Brita pitcher that seniors may be more familiar with lacks hydration reminders and presents an issue of accessibility still. There is this clear untapped market here in combining these two ideas to help seniors hydrate on a daily basis, the people that really need it the most. Waterfall aims to fill this space. Waterfall is a pitcher that reminds you to drink throughout the day. It does this by creating a waterfall effect within the pitcher, serving as an organic and audiovisual reminder to hydrate. Additionally, our assisted pour feature allows users to pour water from the handle without lifting the pitcher. Our team's novel design conceals tubing within the handle. The water is pumped and filtered as it creates the waterfall effect. The spout allows the system to divert the pump's flow for assisted pouring. We've already created a working prototype and are aiming to file a patent early next year. So here's what we need you. We need money to get our patent off the ground and gain full intellectual property to our idea. We want to use Kickstarter next to promote our product and produce and sell our first production run. This will prove a need for the product and get feedback from the users. Next, we want to secure a licensing agreement with a larger company that will allow us to capitalize on their manufacturing abilities and existing user base. As we grow, we can continue to expand our reach and make Waterfall more accessible to everyone, especially in the work from home marketplace. The point of use water treatment industry is a huge $4 billion industry and has seen consistent growth throughout the years. By licensing our design to a major brand such as Brita, we could generate $500,000 of revenue in the first year alone. MEng is a 4-person team who are passionate to make Waterfall into a reality. We have tons of product development experience and the entrepreneur experience, and we have connections to the consumer product industry. Thanks you guys for listening and happy to take any questions.
Yeah, I have a question. Have you actually tested this out on seniors? And what, just curious, like how many seniors have you spoken to and what have you found? Yeah. Or so actually tested it out rather.
Yeah. So we actually have, we started this project by going kind of into the Ithaca community here. And you can see in the prototype zero, we actually just attached a headlamp and a phone into a pitcher and went on the streets and talked to a lot of people. In the prototype one, we have our first prototype, which was working, but not aesthetic. And we actually talked, we brought this to our own grandparents and some family friends and got a lot of opinions on, you know, how big it needed to be, you know, if it would fit in the fridge, if what other additional features we had. The assisted pouring idea was actually from one of these feedbacks. So it was a really helpful exercise to just talk to as many people as we could.
Go ahead, Otto.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Have you then actually like had sort of elderly people then use it for a week or a month or something and see whether they actually are more hydrated?
Yeah. So we've had 2 runs just with family. And we haven't gotten any big number results, but they generally seem to enjoy it. Right now, we're still tweaking it for more consistent performance, and also we're looking at controls more. So kind of the next development in the product itself is kind of getting those finalized.
Super. Have you gone to nursing homes and spoken to people there, and do they say how they deal with giving people water?
Yeah, so when we went to the nursing homes, I think a big point was that the caretakers actually really do care about you know, they're elderly, and they're passionate as much as we are as trying to keep them healthy. And one big thing was a lot of times, I think seniors would struggle because you don't want to be kind of forced water down your throat. You want to kind of, you know, be your own person and have your own autonomy. So when somebody's kind of pushing water in your face, especially as an older person, where that's something you kind of happens to you a lot, I think was really frustrating for some of the elderly and also for the caretakers, because they kind of felt like this was their job and, you know, it was kind of just butting heads with the seniors. So we kind of wanted this product to stand more in the background than something that was in your face with alarms or phone reminders or texts or anything like that. And something that would really just fit in like any other good product.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your response, Michael. Last but not least, in the general track, we have Entombed. So feel free to share your screen, Entombed.
Hello, everyone. My name is Praveen Ganendran, and I am the founder and CEO of Entombed. Consider Ashra, who has written over 25 songs, but released none of them. She didn't know how to produce her music, but was lucky to find me and my producer. Only then were we able to fully produce and release her first single, Loving Me. Today, 90.7% of artists lack the necessary team to pursue their musical ambitions. We realized the importance of a team in music collaboration, forming Entombed, a service designed to match songwriters, producers, and vocalists to help them complete their music projects. Today, we will present our idea and then our market. After studying over 300 matches and 100 user reports from our biggest competitor, Vamper, we identified three key problems in our market. First being the failure to form teams. Competitors only match artists one-on-one, but don't offer the holistic team needed to complete their song. Secondly, the rudimentary matching results in highly experienced and active artists constantly being matched to users that have last logged on a year ago and don't have any music experience. This matching neglects true parameters like skill and engagement that define a successful team. Thirdly, projects are not tracked following the match, creating little accountability and no incentives for completion, contributing to unfinished projects. Thankfully, we have solutions. First, our matchmaking algorithm provides five potential teams to choose from. Each team consists of a vocalist, a producer, and a songwriter, providing the key members to make a song. To address basic matching, we utilize skill and engagement metrics. Engagement is measured by factors such as time spent on the app, number of accepted matches, and complete projects. Skill is measured by numerical surveys that members of the team fill out rating each other. By using surveys that track each teammate's commitment and skill, we can offer better matches. Additionally, video chat features are included to get to know your prospective team better. To increase completion rates, our customizable checkpoints allow teams to map out their own schedules and hold each other accountable to their own deadlines. Therefore, our value propositions include multiple team offerings, optimized matches, rewarding commitment, planned projects, and genuine interaction. Here's our prototype. First, you get the artist profile. Then we generate the matches. Finally, you can view your prospective team member's profile to read about them and get a feel of who they are. Chat if you're interested. We use a freemium model, a free app with premium features that have subscription fees. For example, a premium member can increase their potential team offers from 5 to 10 and increase their matchmaking range to global. We project our customers and revenue growth for the next 5 years to reach 300,000 users and $850,000 in revenue. You can also view our cost distribution. We will use our developed website and social media to post company updates. We have already established connections with artists such as Albie Moreno, the Voice finalist, who believe in our idea to increase market exposure. With your funding, 60% would be allocated towards app development and the remaining towards marketing and R&D. Implementation will be easy once we finalize the algorithm. Our action steps are to polish the algorithm, build a team to make the app, and then launch. We'll receive feedback from users and beta testing to ensure customer satisfaction, and we'll immediately target the discontent users from competitors like Vamper and Pro Collab. We are paid the way for the next era of music creation. Join us.
Thank you for that. Next, we will be having judges Q&A.
Pam, you are muted.
Yeah, have you found a need for this? Like, do you speak to people and do they say, boy, we really need some kind of collaboration and we can't work alone? Like, what have you found since you've done like some kind of customer discovery on this?
Right. So our first way of understanding who our market was actually consulting with users that were using our competitor's app. So my entire startup team, we went on to Vamber, which is currently the biggest music matchmaking service. And we actually studied over 300 matches and interviewed about 30 people inside of the app. We talked to them and got a feel for what their problems were with the app. And what we realized after talking to them was that one of the biggest problems is that many of the matches they felt were inaccurate because they were matched with people that weren't near their skill or weren't as engaged in the app as they were. And they also felt that because projects weren't being tracked and because Vamper simply provided the matches and then just let them do whatever they want, there was no accountability. And therefore they weren't able to complete projects and actually get them released on distributing platforms. So from there, we realized that there was a clear problem coupled with a statistic that 90.7% of artists don't have the necessary team with current market solutions. So we feel that we can capitalize on that market that's currently untapped and growing.
Oh, thank you.
I'm curious about the team makeup here, looking and so you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 men and one woman. I'm curious if you've thought about the team makeup and how that might affect the result.
Yeah, so actually our distribution was mostly just people that I've already been working on music with to begin. So for example, George, who's my executive music producer, was someone that went to my high school. Ash was actually someone that we onboarded from Cornell that I met through classes, and we onboarded her. We're actually working to bring in new members, and we're actually like actively recruiting new members. And we want to make sure that we keep the gender, we don't want to create a gender disparity, because our big goal is to, in fact, address things like the disparity of gender inside of the music industry. So we have been working with Ash to onboard females onto our leadership board. And by the end, we hope to have it equal 50-50 and make sure that there's clear distribution and we're not like an overwhelming amount of like males, but we have an equivalent amount of females and males. And we'll definitely make sure to act on that.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your responses and your questions. And this concludes the general track of our competition. And I will now be passing it on to Nicole, who's the VP of LCL, to present the social track. Nicole, are you there?
Nicole might be having some technical difficulties. So in the meantime, I'll take over. We can have the first presenter for the social track. Please share your screen.
Yeah, that's going to be Neo Glove.
Neo Glove, thank you.
Hi. I'll go ahead and share my screen now. You guys see what I'm seeing?
Yep. Whenever you're ready. Awesome.
Hi, everyone. Welcome. My name is Brian. Today, Sparsh and I will be presenting you our big idea, NeoGlove. How many of you have been wary of touching doorknobs in public spaces with your hands? Have you ever pushed doors with your feet because you wanted to avoid potential germs? I've seen friends, families, and myself constantly relating to this issue more and more each day. I'm sure you can too. So let's talk about the problem at hand. After the advent of the COVID-19 pandemic, people have been increasingly aware of the dangers of coming into direct contact with contaminated surfaces. The risk is especially high for people who frequent high-density public locations. In addition, combine the fact that we touch our faces an average of 16 times per day and that COVID can last on common surfaces such as tabletops, doorknobs, and laptops for up to 5 days, we have the basis for a dangerous combination of high-risk situations. Current solutions address this issue by opening doors with your legs or elbows or by using latex gloves or carrying hand sanitizer. But many of these solutions do not avoid direct contact completely. With gloves, anything that your gloves touch will also be contaminated. However, we've got a new solution. NeoGlove, the first viral repellent glove. NeoGlove is a durable, eco-friendly accessory that is etched with a nanofilm composed of type 4 titanium dioxide. These particles have the property of being super hydrophobic, which essentially means that they're extremely repellent to water-based solvents. Because the COVID-19 virus is primarily a respiratory virus, its medium of travel is through liquid droplets. Hence, by using a hydrophobic glove to touch outdoor surfaces, we're greatly limiting the transmission rate. Our glove aims to last at least 3 to 4 months per pair and is durable enough to go through normal day-to-day use.
So based on over 50 customer interviews, we have identified our initial target market to be essential workers who frequent densely populated areas as part of their daily routine. Specifically, this includes essential employees who work in public transportation services, retail stores, and critical trades like plumbing, construction, and maintenance. Their high-risk exposure requires the use of more effective and reliable protection methods than just disposable gloves or hand sanitizers, and this is exactly what we've heard in our interviews. We estimate our initial market size to be close to 100 million, and our calculations for this can be found in Appendix C. We also have a clear plan for using the funds we receive from the Big Idea Competition in our immediate next steps for growth. So over the next few months, we aim to carry out our first pilot and collect as much user testing data as possible before we develop a final NeoGlove design that can be mass manufactured. A majority of our funding would be used for making gloves for this pilot and developing the titanium dioxide technology into a scalable design. We also plan to reserve roughly 10% of the funds for expenses such as lawyering and patenting fees. My name is Sparsh. You've met my co-founder, Brian. We are NeoGlove and we look forward to working with you. Thank you.
I have a question. So with the COVID pandemic, you know, there's definitely a need for this, but, you know, the hope is that a vaccine is coming, you know, so once we go back to, you know, life as usual, is our workers, is this glove going to be like too heavy? Like I know people in hospitals, frontline workers still wear plastic gloves, but they're lightweight. Like, is it too heavy? Are people going to sweat in it all day?
Yeah, it's a really good question, Marissa. So actually the glove itself is the thickness of two regular latex gloves. So if you imagine wearing one of those latex surgical gloves, that's essentially the type of feeling and type of weight that you're gonna have on your hand. So, and after the COVID pandemic, people are still going to be extremely hyper aware of staying clean and not touching dirty surfaces because we've been primed because of the COVID pandemic. And so we expect this glove to be of use during and after the pandemic because people are more hyper aware and people still want to keep germ free. This was happening before COVID and this will continue to happen even after COVID as well.
Good point.
How would, question for you guys, how much would a pair of gloves cost?
Yeah.
And who would be paying for it? Is it the essential workers or is it the transportation authority? Is it the hospitals?
Right. So we actually have a business model canvas that describes all of our different aspects. So the gloves themselves would cost $25 to make, to manufacture, including the materials, cost of printing, cost of etching, and everything else included. And our customer segment are the essential workers themselves, not the transportation companies, because $25 for a pair of gloves or even more is a big cost for a company to take on for every single one of their workers. So this is more of a personal accessory, as we mentioned earlier.
Plus we also just to add, like since these gloves are reusable, someone can own a personal pair of these gloves. And so we kind of expect people to like buy personal pairs for themselves rather than a corporation to hand out.
This is essentially to protect themselves and their families during COVID and even after.
Is this unique tech? Is there any defensibility here?
Right. So the use of titanium dioxide for super hydrophobic materials has actually been used before by a company called Nanoseptic Materials. And so what they developed are these titanium dioxide stickers that you put on doorknobs and door handles so that when you touch them, you're not transferring the virus onto the handle themselves. So this isn't unique tech, but there's research being done on it at the University of Buffalo, actually. So one of our other teammates is a PhD candidate there, and he is actually prototyping a nanofilm for this compound right now. So this isn't entirely unique, but it's applicable towards gloves, and it hasn't been applied in this manner yet.
Okay, that will be all for Q&A. Sorry about that. Now we will move on to aquaponics at the two Annabelles.
All right, thank you.
Hi,
Hi, everyone. My name is Dylan Rogers, and I'm representing aquaponics and annabelles, which I'll refer to as APTA. And by the way, annabelles is our student-run grocery store. To start, let's talk about the problems our society has, both globally and locally. Globally, we face widespread food insecurity, unsustainable stress on the environment, and unprecedented impacts due to climate change. The question is, how are we going to feed 2 billion more people with relatively less land and resources to do so? Locally, we see these trends reflected as well, with Cornell students facing food insecurity, Cornell's imminent commitment to carbon neutrality by 2035, and limited space at Dillman Hill, our student-run organic farm. The question for us is, how do we sustainably ensure 100% food security on campus? There are many approaches, and a promising one is aquaponics, which integrates fish and crop production by recycling water and nutrients in a nearly closed loop system. This allows us to locally produce both a high protein source and nutritious greens, fruits, and vegetables with less inputs, less land, little to no pollution, waste, or greenhouse gas emissions, and 90% less water than conventional agriculture and aquaculture. In the Cornell microcosm, APTA will exemplify these benefits and more. By partnering with Annabelle's, we will bring fresh and affordable produce to students on campus. And by partnering with Dillman Hill, we will repurpose non-arable land on the farm and also educate students about aquaponic growing. The APTA system itself will be a decoupled deep water culture aquaponic system at Dillman Hill. APTA will derive its nutrients and water from an aquaculture facility elsewhere on campus. This represents a scalable solution that can be applied almost anywhere in the world, and is a proof of concept for a growing technique that could feed the world. Countries, developed, developing, and everywhere in between can use this system and systems similar to it to sustainably increase economic independence and food sovereignty. I've spent the last year and a half immersing myself in aquaponics and made reliable connections with the students, faculty, industry experts, and student organizations needed to ensure APTA success. Cornell has the opportunity to showcase the positive impacts aquaponics can have on our food system, and APTA is the perfect way to begin. Thank you.
If you win, how will you be using the funds?
Excellent question. So the bulk of the funds will be going to constructing this system at Dillman Hill. So we need, this is a pretty accurate picture of what the prototype would look like with these beds that we would need the plastic and wood to, the initial materials to construct. And then part of it will go to ongoing costs for the next year or so, just so that we can start getting these products to market. And of course, not for profit, but we hope to eventually be economically sustainable.
And so aquaponics itself obviously isn't a new idea. But what you're doing here is the idea then you could have universities themselves, like for their own food system, and you duplicate that at other universities, have their own aquaponics? Is that what you're thinking? Curious what the novel idea is here.
So I mentioned very briefly decoupling. So APTA works within existing assets, which I think is the big distinguishing factor. Instead of having to build a whole new fish system or aquaculture system, APTA will utilize resources and waste products that would usually just go down the drain and cause pollution. It repurposes that in a separate hydroponics type system to grow fresh produce. And this is also 100% student driven. So it would kind of serve as this idea that university students can do this and don't need a professor necessarily to get this going. I think initially universities, of course, but in the broader perspective, just the world is, I think these can be applied pretty much, especially in places where aquaculture facilities already exist.
Great. Let's move on to the next one. We have decolonial doula.
All right, can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, hi everyone. My name is Reem. I'm a chemistry major and I'm also a doula. A doula is a support person or a guide. We make sure people's birth plans and autonomous choices are being respected at all stages of the birthing process. Being a doula and attending Cornell brought my attention to the types of choices, plans, and investments we make as students that are not being respected. A Cornell Pulse report found about half of our student population has had severe enough mental health issues that they were unable to function academically for weeks at a time. Every week costs Cornell students about $1,500. In a year, that's $14 million of student investment into their Cornell education that's just not being used appropriately. I was one of those students, and it wasn't because I was too depressed or too anxious to function. It was because I had a learning disability that I did not know about and therefore wasn't being accommodated. Being a STEM major means I'm trained to learn from scientific literature. But learning, on the other hand, is innate. We can all do it. In reality, a learning disability means the way we've built our education system prioritizes one type of learner. We need to decolonize the way we're helping people learn. One way is by taking a closer look at research databases that overwhelmingly still rely on long-written material from established researchers in a variety of fields. Decolonial Doula is a database that completely reimagines the way we present scientific knowledge and research to the public. The website presents itself as an online shopping experience where you can browse topics within relatable and real-life categories like ancestry, eating, and creating. You can explore research topics and add them to your cart as a podcast, as an article, a book, a workshop, a webinar, a video, an art piece. You get to tailor your learning experience, and navigating the database becomes like a choose your own adventure. Decolonial Doula then synthesizes your learning choices into a downloadable workbook or sketchbook, depending on the format that you choose. You can then use this personalized tool to support your understanding of scientific research, seeing how it is applicable to your everyday life, and how it can actually change it for the better. Winning today would catapult me into customer discovery, interviewing researchers about the diversity of ways they have promoted their research worldwide. I'd also like to get to know that 43% of students I mentioned just a little better. I'm a chemistry major, not a computer science major, so I'll need to hire a team for web development and purchase a website domain and template. And finally, I'd like to implement a unique ongoing market research model to help Decolonial Doula evolve every time it's used, making it an emerging art piece. I'm confident Decolonial Doula can guide us into a whole new era of scientific exploration for all. Thank you.
Reem, what sort of customer discovery have you actually done? And besides yourself, which is pretty good, but what other customer discovery?
Sure. Well, being a doula isn't necessarily you become a plurilingual being. So mm-hmm. You have multiple occupations at once. A lot of doulas tend to be anthropologists, tend to be researchers, midwives. It's that they're already producing data and knowledge and trying to put it out into the world, because we have to keep in mind that we have to use evidence-based practices. So doulas have very specific networks. So we keep in contact, especially with the COVID pandemic. Almost everything is virtual. Our services are virtual. In addition to that, I actually host the podcast with my friends. So when I mentioned that 43% of students, I'm usually talking about my friends, right? So if you think about half the student population in a group of 10 people, I'm surrounded by five people who've gone through the same thing.
Oh, good. Thank you. Good answer.
Can you tell me a bit about the business model?
Sure. I would be having a two-sided market. I guess the main income would be coming from researchers who would normally turn to traditional subscription-based databases. So really, I think it would be coming from that side of the market. On the other side is like students, the general public, people who are interested in consuming research and education. But that side is, I thought about making it subscription based, but I think that would actually defeat the purpose. A value that I learned at Cornell that I really hold dear is education is the awakening of the human being. So I believe on that side, it should remain open and free. So it would really be coming from the researchers.
Great. Now we will move on to Verte. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Can you see my screen now, please?
Let me just see the home screen.
All right.
Okay. All right. Now it's good.
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Gilbert Edu. I am a junior here at Cornell, and I am the founder of Verte. So I grew up in a city in Ghana, and anytime I went grocery shopping, I'd notice that the vegetables were browny. And that was because vegetables were transported from rural areas where they were grown to cities where I could find them to buy. Excuse me. So I thought of a solution to curb the problem of browny vegetables, which is to have farms in the cities. Now, we could have farms in the cities, but then there's no arable land in the cities. Therefore, that led me to think about having vertical farms then in the cities. So vertical farming is no new idea, but then I think with my Verte farm, that these are a couple of things that would be unique. First, we wouldn't have any need for soil, for natural soil. And that's because natural soil contains microbes that might compete with the plants for nutrients or might feed off of the plants. So in place of naturally occurring soil, we would use coconut husks, which do not contain microbes. Also, to limit the amount of water spillage, we are going to implement a targeted water supply system, which would ensure that water in our farms would be almost 5% as that would be used in a typical farm. Also, my farm would implement a hybrid form of energy production for plant growth, would use energy from the sun during the day, and during the night would rely on solar cells that would be charged during the day. So this idea takes away the middleman, which is the transport of food from the farms to our homes. And it's for everybody everywhere and can be implemented in every city. Now, the next steps would be to get seeds, coconut husks, and bottles in order to make a tangible prototype farm so I could go on to lobby more from other investors. Thank you.
Gilbert, there's a group called Humans to Humans. Why don't you look into them? Okay, they focused on Ghana for quite a while, and they're helping entrepreneurs with giving them sort of free groups to help them in like marketing, business development, and you might really want to look into them. They actually were at LCL about 2 years ago, but look into them, Humans to Humans, Google them. They've got a website. Do you have anybody helping you right now?
Yes. So currently I'm partnering with a vertical farm back home. Yeah.
Gilbert, how would you fund this operation? You know, real estate in urban areas is extremely expensive. So how are you going to fund this?
Yeah. So I'm looking into not getting anything fancy. I know a vertical farm could literally be implemented anywhere, but for me, I'm actually thinking of like old factories, since those really wouldn't cost much.
If you win, what would be the first thing you do if you get some money?
Call my mom.
I love this kid. He's the winner. Great answer.
No, but like I said in the previous slide, if I win this competition, after calling my mom, obviously I'd be going on then to purchase seeds and husks and bottles, because I realized most of the big names in the vertical farming industry actually use pods, and then they keep on buying these pods. But in order to kind of like contribute a solution to the plastic pollution problem, I noticed we could also use bottles, like normal soda bottles we use every day in place of the pods.
Looks like you're literally looking for seed funding.
Oh man, yep.
Oh God, I forgot Timmy's sense of humor.
great. This was a funny presentation. Yes, and a really great one. So we're gonna move on to GovLink. Great.
Yep, 1 second. Can everyone see my screen?
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. My name is Zuhair, and I will be presenting GovLink, where we are making civic engagement more accessible. So local government meetings are hard to access for a lot of reasons. They used to take vehicles to get to. They require education about the items. But most importantly, they're just super, super long. A public meeting can last anywhere between 3 to 8 hours. And people that attend these meetings, all they want to do is listen to one item or speak for about 3 minutes. And the question we need to ask ourselves is, who can wait 3 to 8 hours just to speak for 3 minutes? And research shows that it's actually the affluent demographics of a community who can afford to stay at these meetings and make decisions that affect all people. So the question is, how do we make it easier for people to participate in these online meetings? And that's where GovLink comes in. GovLink is a software that sends SMS text updates to people throughout meetings. So on the citizen side, what this looks like is I go to a public website, and I would insert my phone number that I would like to receive an update at. And then I can toggle which items I care most about. And then during the meeting, I will receive text updates throughout the meeting about when items are beginning. So when I receive an update, I know I can then hop onto the online link and participate. On the administration side, it's very simple. All admin would have to do is click next item, which would start the sequence of events of sending people text updates. Now, in terms of next steps, throughout this month of December, we'll be building out the product and then testing it in January. What funding will do is help us pay for our website and using the Twilio API. In conclusion, I've talked to elected officials, government administrators, union leadership, and community leaders who all strongly believe that a technology-based tool can help strengthen our democracy and increase equity. Thank you.
How did you get this idea? I think it's a very, having waited way too long in these meetings, I totally appreciate that it's been a, you know, it is a real issue. Just curious how you came to this.
Yeah, so I used to serve as a trustee for our city's Board of Education. So I sat in these hour-long meetings and I noticed that millions and millions of dollars were spent in deciding on the people who could actually show up to the meetings. And unfortunately, it's usually the people that need representation the most that are actually not in the decision-making rooms. So I think, and I talk to a lot of other people who believe that we need to make cities more equitable, that getting more people into board meetings is one of the best solutions to provide.
And then tell me what happens. And so they get the message that their thing is up. Is there then now like it's a Zoom thing? So answer that.
Yeah, so because of COVID-19, All meetings are happening online, and like same thing with participation. So people are, you know, hopping onto Zoom meetings similar to like just like this, and you know, like we'll speak directly through Zoom. And part of the update would be a link to the Zoom meeting, so people can just like click on the link and participate. Now, the question that is like pretty interesting is what happens in like a post-COVID era. And I'm talking to some people who still think that government participation through an online medium may still continue to happen. So I do believe that there is opportunity to use this idea in a post-COVID world as well.
Who pays?
That's a good question. Initially, I want to build this out so it's free to people and free to governments. I know that budgets are very tight. However, all public institutions have a budget for public relations and communications, and ideally it would be governments who pay. And the incentive for them is that when more people when more people show up to board meetings, it reduces the need for Freedom of Information Act, actions after meetings, where administration has to like, follow up with people who have questions about the meeting and like answer their questions. So it's a huge time save for administration if they can get more people to meetings when they happen.
Great. And that's the end of the Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you.
We will be now showing OMG Oats. I will be sharing that screen. And all right, can everybody see my screen? Mm-hmm. Great. Amanda, whenever you're ready.
Hi, everyone. Before I start, I just want to say thank you to all the judges for sitting through all of our pitches. I know it's a long time, and I know that last one of the day is, it's been a long day, so thank you, everyone, for your time. Okay. My name is Amanda Hartman, and I'm representing Team OMG Oats. Next slide, please. I have an important question to ask all of you. How often did you visit the farmers market last year? If you're like me and a large percentage of other college students, your answer will be zero. Next slide, please. In fact, when I asked 101 Cornell and Binghamton University students this very question, I discovered nearly 30% of students had never gone to their local farmers market. This is a problem, not only for local food producers who rely on consumer foot traffic at farmers market for support, because buying local has been shown to be better for the environment. Next slide, please. Next one. So why does this problem exist? It's not because students aren't interested in buying local. 35.4% of the students I surveyed said buying local was very important to them. The issue is deeper than that. Going to farmers markets or buying direct from nearby farms can be expensive and inconvenient, and many students lack the time, money, and personal transportation to visit farmers markets consistently. Next slide, please. So how do we solve this problem? OMG Oats aims to be in every campus eatery in the Ithaca area, allowing students with limited time or money to enjoy minimally processed, ready-to-eat overnight oats that are portable, delicious, and feature ingredients from community food producers. By supporting OMG Oats, consumers are also supporting local food producers, ensuring that buying local is as easy as it is convenient. Essentially, OMG Oats brings the farmers market to you. Next slide, please. One such community food producer is the Menda family. The Mendas own a small family apiary called Gill's Honeybees in Ithaca. Along with the Mendas, at least four other local producers will be supported with every purchase of OMG Oats. Next slide, please. But making it easier for college students to support local food producers isn't just the right thing to do. College students represent an almost $600 billion market, and farm-to-college dining is taking New England by storm. In 2015, 95% of colleges surveyed reported that they purchased local food for their dining services. And on average, colleges and universities spent over 1/5 of their annual budget on local food. Working with Cornell and Binghamton to get OMG Oats into campus dining halls and eateries will help to serve a market with pent-up demand for local food while supporting local businesses at the same time. Next slide, please. Although overnight oats is a crowded space, only brands Mush and Brekkie are ready to eat, and no other brand utilizes local ingredients. Only Quaker Overnight Oats is as accessible to our local market, but the quality of ingredients is much lower and the time cost to consumers is much higher since consumers have to soak the oats themselves. Next slide, please. In terms of next steps, I need to hire a graphic designer and comply with various regulations before I can begin crafting OMG Oats in a commercial kitchen. My goal is to eventually get a contract with Cornell Dining and other local universities before hopefully expanding to other parts of New York State. Next slide, please. Please join me in helping to support community agriculture with OMG Oats. Thank you.
Amanda, great presentation. I see that you kind of outlined some pretty big competitors there. Curious on if you've thought about like how you go about raising awareness of this, you know, of this product and how you would go about trying to, you know, supersede a Quaker Oats type, you know, monster of a company.
Definitely. Yeah. So like the product itself, I think awareness would come from a lot of grassroots effort. I'm not really trying to compete with Quaker Overnight Oats necessarily, because like I mentioned, they're a product where you buy it, the oats are dehydrated, and then you have to fill it with, you know, almond milk or whole milk yourself and then leave it in the fridge overnight. So to me, that's a huge time cost to the consumer. When I was first doing customer discovery and I was looking at brands that were already on the market, I bought a brand from Whole Foods, Elizabeth's, and it sat in my cabinet for like 8 months and I never actually opened it because it was such a pain. Mm-hmm. The main differentiator for OMG Oats is the fact that it's ready to eat. And brands Mush and Brekkie, I consider to be much bigger competitors just because they're playing in that same space.
Great answer. Thank you.
Amanda, what's the shelf life on your product?
That's a really good question. So when I was doing like product testing myself, it was a week, maybe a week and a half, but that's actually one of the tests that I would have to pay for. The Cornell Food Venture Center is a great resource for businesses both in and out of New York State. There's a slight discount for sending samples if you're a business registered in New York State, which I tend to be, but it's still expensive. So that nutritional analysis and hazard analysis point is a test that I would have to pay for. So I guess short answer is about a week. Longer answer is I have to pay to find out.
Well, if you win, you can use the money.
Exactly. Yeah, that's one of the reasons. Why.
Great. That will conclude all the pitches for today.
Wow.
Great.
That was great. Excellent.
All right. Now it will be time for the judges to deliberate. And in that meantime, we will put in the chat the people's choice vote. We will also be doing the raffle during this time.
Great, and I just posted in the group chat the tiny URL. I'll post it again in case it gets lost in the messages.
Great. We'll take 2 minutes do this, and then we'll close the poll officially.
Yeah, and please don't go anywhere, because once we close the poll, we will do some announcements. We'll go through the winners. And we're going to ask that the panelists, as in presenters, do not vote, please. This is the audience choice vote.
I mean, when do we go to the judge deliberation room?
Now.
Is now
the yes. Zoom links privately through Zoom chat, and also it should be on your calendars.
Okay.
So we should leave this.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
A separate Zoom link.
And while judges leave, head over to the other link for the, I believe, 10 minutes allotted, but it may be quicker to sure. deliberate and come back, announce the winners. I forget, just making sure, Jojo or Nicole or Timmy, one of you going with the judges to
Jojo.
Time, okay, and then coming back to this link if they need it, yeah.
Great, yeah, and in about 60 seconds, I'll close the audience choice vote.
Jojo will go in with the judges and return after the winners are selected.
Yep. And I have to echo what Amanda said earlier. Thank you for sticking with us to the very end. I know it's been a long day, but as you can see, we have a great, wonderful group of entrepreneurs here. And it's just wonderful that all of you guys came out to support and to see what we've been cooking up.
Oh, I believe the link disappeared. Can you post it again?
Yep, I'll do that again.
Okay, thank you.
Great, I will be closing the poll now.
Great. So we're gonna get things going. And we're gonna talk a little bit about LCL, one of the hosts for today's event.
And just to clarify, Nicole, did you need to refresh the, or is that, oh, never mind. Don't worry about it, continue, sorry.
Okay, so we're gonna just talk about briefly what LCL is. So LCL, Life Changing Labs, we are guided by this vision that every student with a big idea deserves a platform as bold as their vision. So again, we are all about empowering student entrepreneurs. We started off as an organization. Peter Cordell, who is also on here, is a Cornell alum who started it all. And from his time to now, we have impacted so many students, over 3,500. We've partnered or had 51 startups participating in our summer incubator, and millions of dollars raised in those startups. For the staples of LCL, that is really the community events that we have. Normally in person, we would have community dinners. We are going to have more networking events in the spring, so keep an eye out for that. Entrepreneurial resources, we've had a development series where we show where people can go from idea to implementation, tech to eShip. So those programs will still continue on to spring. And then we have the summer incubator looking forward or upcoming. And then for just a brief overview of our mission and values, again, we like to empower student entrepreneurs and create more of a vibrant and lively community of student entrepreneurs. What we say at LCL, when you join us, you join LCL's network and family. Startup development is always important for any incubator, but we also value personal development in this. We want you to get as much out of it as we will. So, and then also in the people that we invite to our competitions, to our incubators, to our events, we look for people that have passion in everything they do. And we can say that that still rings true with a lot of the people that are still in our network. So I'm going to pass it on to Timmy, who will talk more about our upcoming summer incubator.
Yes, thank you, Nicole. And I couldn't have said it better about what LCL truly embodies. And every summer we run a incubator. And what it is in essence, a group of entrepreneurs who really are passionate about building a company. They have a vision, and it's a 8-week program and over the summer in June and July. The winner of the big idea competition in both tracks will get automatic admission into our incubator, but we encourage everyone to apply. And I think what really makes our incubator great, besides the regular the regular stuff that we planned, such as the speaker series and the pitch practices and the mentoring relationships that we build for you guys, is this sense of community. And actually, Nicole, if you want to advance to the next slide, I have a photo that I added. When she gets back. Even though we are now virtual, it's still a very strong community. From the testimonials, oh, there we go. So that was when we had our physical incubator. But I think even though we're virtual now, the testimonials show that people really value having this home, this community, and ultimately a powerful network of other entrepreneurs. If you are a founder who has a confident vision and you've demonstrated traction, we'd love to have you this summer. But also, if you don't have an idea, but you want to join a founder who does, we're also looking for people who want to join as well. Nicole, if you want to go to the next slide. Applications will open up in January for the summer incubator.
Great. Thanks, Timmy and Nicole. I think that gives, just about in terms of like filling time as well, judges enough time, and we look forward to them returning soon for the announcement. Yeah.
Great. And it looks like, let's see, I'm told that Marissa and Pam need links to the judging room. Let's see. Nicole, you have that link, right? The judging link.
Okay. I think we can move on to the raffles and the people's choice.
Yeah, I'm ready.
Okay.
Cool. Awesome. One second while I share my screen. All right, so let's jump right into raffle time. Five lucky winners: Michael, Gabby, Valeria, Jacob, and Adi. Please email Nicole if you want to put our email in the chat. Please email that email and we will follow up with all of the prize information, but congratulations on being chosen. Super exciting stuff. Cool. She's put it in there now. So just feel free to email us whenever. And I guess we can go into the People's Choice Awards. So drum roll, I guess only on my end. We have Proper Bid. Congratulations. Presentation is amazing. And it looks like everyone else here believes that as well. So great job there. And you will be receiving a $300 in prize money in terms of being the People's Choice vote. Next, we will be progressing to the general category, which I think Nicole will now share her screen.
Wait, are the judges back, or maybe just my end?
Oh, we need a bit of time.
Okay, we'll give them a bit of time first.
Yeah, we'll stall. But once again, thank you, Lucy, Nicole, Jojo, rest of the team, Timmy, everyone who made this possible. I see some good feedback from Deb and others here in terms of how this was run. And once judges are back, we'll make the announcement. And Actually, also kudos for doing a great job on the time as well. So always finishing these things early is a plus, and we're 20 minutes ahead. So as soon as judges get back, we'll look to wrap up with the announcement. Nicole's email. Oh, who do I email for the raffle winner prize?
You're gonna email, I'll put it in the chat actually.
Okay.
It'll be okay. LCL's email.
Yeah, I just put it in the chat, so.
Okay, great. Got it. Yeah, so if you are a winner, please email that.
This was a live version we've done in the past, like a elevator pitch round for those in the audience. But you know, with webinar, Zoom, only panelists can speak and be seen. So perhaps next time.
Peter, would you like to give an elevator pitch?
I'm all set. Doing my best to stall for the judges here, but yeah, great. Oh, actually I didn't get a chance to tell the presenters, but yeah, all the students, like really fantastic job, and looking forward to whether it's like LCL or eLab Accelerator. Some of you already know about that. During the semester, you can earn credits while working on your startup. I'll look forward to some of you like taking the next steps forward. So awesome job presenting today. Let's see here.
I think I'm gonna put on some background music while we're waiting. So open to taking any song suggestions, but I think I'm gonna start with a Khalid song, one of my favorites.
I wish I had learned how to juggle, then I could juggle for you guys, but. Oh, and Lucy, you're aware that there's a way to share your sound as well.
Tim, in terms of anything back real quick before perhaps music starts, in terms of judges, how much more time they need?
Yep, so they are working on the general track right now, is what I'm being told by Jojo.
Okay, yeah. Let me know if you hear the sound, but I'm playing right now. Hear it?
Yeah.
Saturday night, no basic girl looks. Swishes make my throat hurt. Rolling up CDs in the side for me. Light them up and let them both burn. Family feud, saying mom's confused. I for sure she doesn't wanna learn. But daddy's gone, say he's never home. And wishing only makes it worse. I guess there's certain dreams that you gotta keep. As the holy.
Lucy, I'll do the music. Lucy.
All the things that I know.
Yeah, if you let me do the screen share, I'll do the music. There's. Bear with me 1 second.
Is this like rotating DJ going on here? It's like someone else in queue or?
Yeah, I'm just, no, because the audio is better on my computer, so. How do I?
Well, Also, take this opportunity to thank everyone in the audience as well. Some familiar names. Also, there were more people, I think, at the peak earlier, I noticed. But yeah, those of you I know can't speak or the audio isn't possible. But yeah, thank you all for attending, supporting, coming out to see all the pitches. And also some of you who've mentored our teams, our students, and again, many of them presenting for the first time in this type of environment. We thank you for the time and effort you put in to the Big Idea competition as well.
You guys can hear the music? No? Okay.
It's okay. I'm sure judges will be back soon. Yeah. Jenna in the chat box there as well. It's like the longest anticipation building up of any competition I've been a part of, so. Timmy, any perhaps appropriate icebreaker question that entrepreneurship related, where some of the student participants' Big Idea can get us a little more sense of, like, you know, community related interaction? Not to put you on the spot.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Yeah. So if any of our panelists want to chime in, you know, talk about a entrepreneur or a leader that they look up to, and, you know, what is that leadership characteristic that you admire so much? It's like an icebreaker question I sometimes use.
Any brave person, especially those who did not get to present for your team, must be someone you at least reference in terms of entrepreneur out there. Everyone's just waiting for the winner announcement.
Yeah. Peter, is there someone you look up to and admire?
Well, not in terms of like entrepreneur wise. I reference lots, but yeah, I think a little bit different in terms of like benchmarking entrepreneurs, but not necessarily looking up to them. So perhaps the wrong person to pick for this icebreaker question. Yeah. See here. Okay, any update from the judges side?
Yeah, I just got an update. We are going, judges are going to be coming back in about 3 to 4 minutes. So we're almost there.
Okay.
Yep.
Sounds good.
So a Roman walks into a bar and he he goes to the bartender. He holds up two fingers and says, five beers, please.
How many altos does it take to change a light bulb?
How many?
None, because they can't get that high.
If anyone does stand-ups, I guess this is the opportunity. Here's some muted smiles or laughs and LOLs here. Just a couple more minutes to go, everyone. I guess we will finish right on the mark after the announcements.
Cause you have to stay up working late at a job you hate and fix your makeup in the dirty bathroom. No more love in the nightclubs. Know what you gotta do. You got plans wrapped in rubber bands, and that's the only thing you never lose. I guess there's certain dreams that you gotta keep, cause they'll only know what you let them see. All the things that I know that your parents don't, they don't care like I do, nowhere like I do. And all the things that I know that your parents don't, they don't care like I do, nowhere like I do, nowhere like I do. Cause I care. I care about you. There's nowhere I'd rather be than right here around. I care.
Peter, I just sent you a text message, by the way.
better off believing what the ignorance suggests. I wish living life was easy, but mine has been a mess. They say it comes with the seasons, but the seasons come and go, they go. I go blurry when I'm thinking, is it me or vertigo? Criticized, who am I to give up? And breathing, what's the reason to let up? Criticized, who am I to give up? Putting on my favorite
well, judges must they must be having a tough time selecting winners. Usually it's, you know, 10 minutes and they've decided and announced, but we'll attribute that to the great presentations, so making it not
yeah easy. I can confirm that they're in the social track.
Okay.
They're just finalizing social.
Thank you. Suggests a dance competition. Whoever else dances can feel free to dance.
Okay, we're set to go.
Great.
Saved by the bell.
Great. Thank you, everyone, for sticking with us. We will now announce the winners.
Third place to first place, correct? Okay.
Yes, we'll start with general track first and social track. Just another note, if you are a first place winner, you get automatic admission into LCL's summer incubator. So yeah, and also the prize money. So that's great.
Although money is not everything, right, at the end of the day?
Right, but it does help it grow, you know. So, okay, great.
All right, ready with the slides.
All right, the moment that we've all been waiting for. I know we've all been waiting for this.
Wait, can I just say that, like,
yes,
everybody, I was so impressed by everybody's presentation, and there are so many super interesting ideas that I hope that the verdicts here don't dissuade anyone from pursuing their ideas, because I think they're all worthwhile, and happy to help, you know, behind the scenes in terms of crafting different ideas, because I think there's some really super interesting ones that may or may not be recognized here.
Yeah, thank you for that note. Are there any other judges' comments that you'd like to add before we announce winners? Any comments?
Thank you, Susan, for what you mentioned. I encourage those of you like serious about taking the next steps, like Susan and other judges here, like very much in terms of like their experience and background wise, like take full advantage when Susan and others offer those type of opportunities. But thank you for that. Yeah, like regardless of today's result, like big idea being that first step, highly encouraged. So appreciate Susan's comments.
Right, great. Let's move on.
Ready when you are, Nicole.
No, I'm ready for you.
To move okay. Slide. Yeah.
I mean, I will speak. It's just the slide. Yep. Great. All right. So the general track winners are at second place. We have Proper Bid. Round of applause for them. I just would like to note there is no third place winner. So we have a tie for first. So great. Second place, Proper Bid. And the winner, or in this case, winners of the general track are Waterfall and Rehab. Yay. Great job, guys.
Great job, guys. Congratulations. And I guess now we'll go into the social track winners. For third place, we have OMG Oats. Congratulations. Yay. We see everyone clapping muted. It's funny. second place, we have Neo Glove. Yay. And last but certainly not least, the social category winner for this year's 2020 BIC competition is GovLink. Congratulations. Yay. Are there any feedbacks from the judges that you guys want to say before we end things off?
No, all of us enjoyed it. That's why it took so long to deliberate. I mean, everybody's pitch was great. You know, they weren't rambling pitches. They were right to the point. And I had a great time. Thank you very much, everybody. You know what might be helpful? I don't know if you want to. Oh, for motivation. Okay. You might want to give, you can certainly give my email out to anybody because I was so impressed by so many of the groups. And if the other judges feel the same, that would be fine.
Yeah, same here.
Yes. Oh, great. Terrific.
And I have experience with consumer products. So if anyone with the consumer product idea needs any help, I'm happy to help. And e-commerce.
Oh, terrific. Thanks, Marissa.
So wonderful. Yeah. Thanks again to everyone, judges, for your time. We went a little over all the audience members, all the participants, Aram, prior LCL student president as well, giving encouraging link and message there in the chat box. So yeah, thank you all. And thank you once again, LCL team, for putting this together. And hope everyone has a nice weekend.
Yeah. Great job, LCL.
Thank you.
Great
job, everyone.
You guys did great.
Yes, everyone did fantastic.
It was amazing.
We encourage everyone to be inspired to apply to the summer incubator. And for those who had placements in this competition, we will follow up with you in terms of funding and next steps.
Wonderful.
Yeah. All other interested parties, feel free to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn, or check us out on our website. And you can sign up for a newsletter, which we have a lot of other opportunities other than competitions that we have available for the next semesters. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming up and showing up on a Friday. And I hope that you feel inspired from all of our wonderful pitches. And congratulations again to all of our winners. And yeah, have a great Friday and thanks for being here with us today.
It was terrific. Bye, guys. Bye. I loved it.
Thank you.
Stay safe, everyone.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, everyone. Great job.
Bye, Brian.
Have a wonderful weekend.